up from falling, falling back again. Falling back again, again. Falling back again. Falling back again. Falling back again. Baby, in the afternoon. Falling back again. Falling back again.
Hello.
Oh, hi. Just testing the mic.
Test. Podium mic check. Podium mic check. Podium mic check. Party mic check.
Cool, thanks. Okay, let's back up.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to Houston Oasis. My name is Alexis Podvin, and I'll be the MC today. We've got, I like to kick off every Sunday with highlighting a couple of our core values that I feel like particularly resonate with the talk. And so today I want to highlight reality is known through reason and human hands solve human problems. We have an awesome lineup for you today. We've got a couple songs from Joseph Rauma, and our main talk will be given by Brandon Baldwin. So let's go ahead and get this morning started with a couple songs.
Good morning. Check, check, 1, 2.
Thank you.
much. I figure I'll go with another song that's kind of from that same era.
Trying to loosen my load, I've got seven women on my mind. Four that wanna hold me, two that wanna stone me, one says she's a friend of mine. Take it easy, take it easy. Don't let the sound of them old wheels drive me crazy. I know why you still can. Don't even try to understand. Just find a place to make your stand. Take it easy. Standing on a corner out in Winslow, Arizona, such a fine sight to see. It's a girl, my lord, in a flatbed Ford. She's slowing down to take a look at me. Come on, baby. Trying to loosen my load, got a world of trouble on my mind. Looking for a lover who won't blow my cover. She's so hard to find. Come on, baby, take it easy. Don't let the sound of them old wheels drive you crazy. Come on, baby. Don't say maybe. I gotta know if your sweet love is gonna save me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. All right, our main speaker today is no stranger to the Oasis community. Brandon Baldwin has been a longtime member of Oasis, even if you went a while for a little bit and now you're back. It's he is also a popular YouTuber, so please help welcome to the front, Brandon Baldwin.
So today we're going to talk about how artificial intelligence is transforming our world. I got to say that music was awesome. Thank you so much for that. Give another round of applause for that music. All right. So thanks so much for coming to Oasis. Today I'm going to talk about like how artificial intelligence has evolved over some of the years here and what are the different and how it's going to be impacting our society or how I think it's likely going to be impacting our society. And then I'm going to give you a bunch of examples, and we're actually going to interact with some AI here if I can do it or not. I actually got to get connected to the internet phone. But I will try to take some suggestions from the audience, and while I put it into the AI engines and produce some images and interact with some chat bots and stuff like that, so should be fun. Okay, so that image behind us right there is an AI generated image that I asked the AI to create based on what is the ultimate visual form of what AI will take place in the future, and that's what it put out. Pretty interesting. All right. So, goals for the day. We're going to go over the types of AI, the currently active AI applications, emerging applications of AI, and likely possibilities in the future, and then how we can protect ourselves as a society, and then of course we're going to do some demonstrations, kind of basically what I just said. So, benefits of AI. They can literally, AI can almost literally answer any question at this point. You can go in there, if it's a known human answer, it's available public knowledge, it can be an expert in almost every single field on the fly. No matter what you ask, it'll be able to at least give you a generally excellent response that you'd be able to find looking up online. Now, the thing is, it's not consistent, not perfectly consistent yet. Quality of answers will vary a lot, but you'll at least get an answer, all right? So you can create almost any image you can think of based on verbal cues. You put a description into AI engines, and you can have some incredible visualizations coming out of the AI engines within like a minute. It's really awesome to see. This image behind us, by the way, this cat image was another AI image that another user had created on the Discord, and I just pulled it and put it at the background. I thought it was pretty cute. So they were looking for a police inspector that was a large fat cat, was the description, I believe. So we're going to talk also about how AI, you can use AI tools in your business or personal applications. So like some of us, like today, you may want to create a speech, or you've got a funeral coming up and you need to give a eulogy. You've got an email you need to write that's a very important business email. These tools, these AI tools, are perfectly engineered and designed to help you make whatever you write better, appear more professional, whatever. And it's kind of scary how it takes the human element out of it, honestly. Just a little bit of human guidance, it puts out some really detailed stuff. So, for example, and it's kind of dangerous in a sense, too, because I've got someone I know, I'll call him a friend, he runs a company, and he writes articles that he publishes online. He does not disclose that it was written by an AI, but he basically puts in three to five sentences of words, and he'll have like a two-page detailed written article on whatever he had summarized. Like all extrapolated out with source quotes and everything. And it takes him 30 seconds to make it, or maybe like a minute to make it. And then he publishes it under his name as if it's a full written article. And this is happening all over the place on the internet right now. Definitely happening right now. So now that does take some human guidance, right? Because you've got to make sure you quality check that before you publish it under your name. And to me, personally, it's an ethical concern, because people are basically putting out this work claiming it's theirs and it's not really theirs. They just kind of guided the AI and double-checked it, and it's a very big gray area. There's going to be AI tools to create music, AI tools that we're going to look at today to create art, voice tools, voiceovers, facial animations, all kinds of stuff's coming out right now in the works, and it is currently emerging. And we're going to go through a bunch of examples of that today. Medical breakthroughs are coming faster than ever. They're able to analyze our DNA sequencing so much faster with AI models to understand how our genetics work. And there's recently been some testing done of medical doctors, like doctor AIs, that are given like the initial symptoms of whatever the person is suffering from. And the doctor was 80% of the time, the AI doctor was 80% of the time more accurate than the human doctor in diagnosing the problems of the patient. And these kinds of medical breakthroughs, if they're available to the public, this could be huge for third world countries that have very little doctors or very minimal doctors. Think about just using this as a companion if you are a doctor, being able to plug the symptoms in and see what does the AI think could be the possibilities here, and then narrowing it down from there. Or if you have no access to a doctor, being able to access some of these medical AI in the middle of nowhere, as long as there's like satellite internet or something in, say, Africa, it could transform the medical industry in these worlds across the whole world. Another benefit is humans will eventually be able to work less and enjoy life more. That's already happening. Think about 100 years ago versus today. All the automation, the factories, the amount of things we can produce, the things we can enjoy in life, all of that is transformed. Yes, all those jobs went away. All the horse and cart buggies and think about like all the industrial applications we've had with machinery and then automated machinery. All of those factory workers can now go out there and get a different kind of education or a different type of job application. And there's a lot of benefits. Now, there are also a lot of downsides too. So we're gonna talk about kind of pros and cons here. But many benefits we can't even predict at this time because AI is evolving so fast. Like things that I didn't think possible 5 years ago are already possible today. Because I never thought that AI would be able to create images like this cat behind us here in less than a minute. Like a real artist creating that is gonna take so long. It's gonna take hours and hours of work, and an AI can put that together in less than a minute. All right, so types of AI, this is very broad. There's a lot of different rankings, categories, types of AI out there. In general, I've narrowed it down to three broad types, but there are arguably more types than that, just for the sake of simplicity. So narrow and reactive types are automatic programmed responses to inputs. It does not grow. A narrow or a reactive AI does not grow. It does not evolve over time. It stays static. A super, super basic example of a programmed narrow AI would be something like probably a good example would be like, you know, the self-checkout lines at Walmart. That's like a self, like a programmed little AI there that makes sure that you scan every grocery, that the weight is all correct. If you detect something wrong, it calls an attendant over to check out what you've done wrong. Even more simple might you could claim is like a little computer that detects whether there's motion at a door and then opens the door, like at the entrance to a grocery store. Like that kind of thing is a super simplistic. More complex narrow reactive AI would be something like Siri, where it's like an AI assistant that's on your phone. It's programmable and maybe it can evolve, but only it doesn't automatically evolve. All right? Limited memory AIs evolve and improve based on user feedback. They use deep learning and data mining to identify patterns in the data, analyze images. And basically, based on how the users respond, it will grow and iterate and improve. And then there's theory of mind, self-aware AI. This is the AI then understands that they're making something, they're doing things, they're an entity in the world, and they're doing things that interact with other entities in the world. Like limited memory AIs are just doing a task. It may be a complicated task, like putting together an image, but a limited memory AI doesn't realize that it's making it for you to please your mind, or it's just making it so that it gets the most optimal feedback. That's it. It's just a feedback in and out. So those are the three broad categories that I would describe for types of AI. This was a really funny, this kind of breaks down a little bit more what I was talking about narrow AIs, but look at the image right here. I guess you can't really see it, right here. I don't know if you can see it, but it's a child with a mustache. The AI decided that it was a good idea to put a child with a mustache there, and it was not at all the prompt. You can see that the girl on the left does not have a mustache. The girl on the right does. So more examples of limited AI is going to be something like YouTube, Google, and Facebook attention algorithms as they do deep dives on how users interact with their websites. And they try to optimize the content they put out for the longest attention span. Generative AIs, like Midjourney, DID, and DALL-E. So Midjourney is an image generation tool. We're going to try that today if I can get that working, maybe after the coffee break. DID is a facial animation, so it can take a still image of someone's face, and then their goal is to make it realistically animate their face into movements just off of a still image. So simulating their teeth, their muscles, their mouth, the 3D aspects of the face. And DALL-E is another image generator. Language AIs like ChatGPT and Jasper. You've probably heard of ChatGPT. You can interact with ChatGPT. We're going to try to do that today as well. But those language AIs, they have processed and data mined just huge libraries of websites, articles, books. And they've taken that knowledge, and they've not just like copy and pasting it back to you. They've actually processed it, regurgitated it, tried to summarize that information down, and analyzed it to a much greater degree than your typical search engine and response would give you. So you can interact with it about topics conceptually on a deeper level than just what is blah, blah, blah. You could ask, you can dive deeper. Like secondary level, you know, you could ask, what is philosophy? And then it would be like, philosophy is like the theory of the world and our minds, or, you know, whatever definition it spits out. And then you could ask follow-up questions that are like theoretical, and that can give its theoretical take after it's data mined all this information. So it's high concept stuff that is very interesting. And then of course there's robotic task-based AI like Boston Dynamics. I've got an example video for you guys of that, but they are a company designed, their goal is to create robotic bodies that can learn and interact with 3D spaces as well as humans, maybe even better than humans eventually. And they've done an amazing job creating these robots that can literally do parkour, jumping, dancing, moving around. There's all kinds of potential applications, including, of course, warfare, potentially. Though I believe Boston Dynamics, they said their goal is not to do any kind of warfare creation, right? So, but theoretically, say if China were to get a copy of it, then adapt the type of technology, it could be something that could be used for warfare, just as an example. All right, so. Whatever the algorithm has decided is the most attention getting. And we've seen this really affect our society as people get stuck in bubbles. Their little intellectual bubble, don't hear or understand any type of news outside of their general bubble of what information they get, either in Fox News or maybe CNN or whatever genre, liberal, conservative. There's very little mixing going on of information within social media because of how the algorithms have optimized for user attention rate. AI empowers fewer individuals to do the same amount of work with less humans needed. This is definitely happening right now, and this is a big part of what's happening. Imagine, you guys can't really see the image behind us right now. There is a kitty cat with making food. I can probably make it pronounced here. Can you see it now? So when you think about an artist that makes these kinds of art, because these kinds of art existed before AI made this cat, right? That artist is almost out of a job, not quite. But let's say that they can make this art tool like Midjourney and tweak it and put it out and sell it. People have been using this to create coloring books, all kinds of stuff. And basically, these AI tools, from programming, engineering standpoints, medical doctors, to artists, all these AI tools are going to empower one person to do the same work that three people used to do, five people used to do. And then eventually, when it's so good, so accurate, that people trust it, 1-100 ratio maybe. One person can do the work of 100 people verifying. It's going to depend, and eventually maybe maybe no humans will ever be needed in those fields. Again, just in the same way, we don't need a lot of, you know, we don't need water carriers anymore carrying our water for us. That used to be a job in society. You know, we've evolved. Our society has changed so much in the last 200 years, 100 years, 50 years, 10 years even. And it's going to keep changing. Okay, so now hopefully you guys are going to be able to, I went ahead and kept these on a white background. So how will AI impact us in the future? As AI improves, more complex tasks will become automated simply because the AI is going to get smarter and better at doing these tasks, tasks that you never thought would be possible by an AI. We can imagine a world where there's no taxi drivers, cashiers, security guards, or factory workers as these jobs are replaced by AI, robotic people, or robotic, robots, AI-powered robots, smart cars driving semi-trucks. Once we reach a point where AI is consistently better than a human at the job, like almost every time, that's when it's really going to switch over in full swing, when smart cars truly are a better driver than a human. Right now, I don't think we're there yet. We're still, it's a more complicated task than I think people predicted. Being able to analyze camera images in live and, you know, sensor data in live and be able to predict what car is going to go where or where the car needs to go. But we're going to get there. It's going to happen. 50 years from now, self-driving cars are not going to be very common, I don't think. It's going to be more of like an antique fun thing to do, having a driver's license. I don't know. That's what I'm predicting. What about creative jobs? Engineering, programming, if you're an artist. Like, these are the kinds of things that are funded by need. And if these companies no longer need the human to do it, because they can just ask an AI to create this app that does this thing, and the AI can make it in 2 minutes, why would you need to pay a human 40 hours to do the same task? Like, that's the reality that we're going to be seeing here in the next 20, 30, 50 years. It's going to get there eventually. We're not there yet. But even the AI tools and the programming, right now there are AI tools. But when the AI no longer needs a human to tweak it, to fix it, then why do we need programmers in general, right? That's going to be more of a maintenance, highly specialized job. I think over the next hundred years, billions of jobs are going to disappear, never to be seen again. And what are we going to do? You know, what does a world look like when there's no taxi drivers, cashiers, security guards? Imagine a world where to create a book, all you have to do is copy the of movie. That's it. That's all that's required. Now you could tweak it to make it better or fix the little AI errors that pop up, but that is going to happen. That'll be a reality. Imagine a world where education are all handled by AI. If you really want to learn about a topic, you can go right now to ChatGPT, type in there what do you want to learn about aerospace engineering or whatever, and you can get good resources, point you in the right direction, can use it as a tutor essentially to guide your knowledge. But I think ultimately when an AI masters these tasks, the AI is not going to die. Like you think about like a master craftsman, from the human perspective. We need, let's say there's a human need for 10,000 architects in America. Like, they're really good. They build all the skyscrapers or whatever. You know, like maybe 100,000, whatever. What happens when the AI masters that? The AI is never going to die. The AI is not going to go away. Those 100,000 architects that kept those jobs going for the last, 100 years, they keep dying, and new ones need to be trained and educated and brought into society and new jobs created in that sense of just like replacement. But AIs are never going to go away. They're just going to keep getting better. So once the AI replaces it, that job is gone, essentially, unless there's a very specific need for, I don't know, some human interaction, or like a guy, whoever makes it wants the human interaction. I think that's a big part of the draw in the future is, was this made by a human or was this made by an AI? And I think the human need for something that was made by another human could be a strong driving factor for like human artists being able to survive and continue their livelihood, for example. But only the truly talented will be able to compete with like the AI stuff. So how can we protect society? How I think it's important that we recognize that in 5, 25, 50 years from now, most of the jobs that we know today are gonna be replaced by AI eventually. And so we need to have the mindset of like, how do we prepare society? How do we transform our society to one where not all of the power goes to people that control the AI, right? Because whoever controls these AIs ultimately are gonna control that industry. It's gonna be like an extreme monopoly in some instances. So the more difficult the task is to automate, the longer it is it's gonna take to create an AI for that task, but eventually I think almost all of these complex tasks will be figured out, learned, and AI will be taking them over. So we need to prepare ourselves for a world where AI and automation benefits the 99% of the population and not just the 1% who maybe created that AI. So what that means is we need to have laws and regulations in place that's going to allow for the ultra wealthy who own the AI. So for example, some people believe that AI should be an open source type of thing, where anyone can access it, anyone can profit from it, anyone can use it. There is a downside to that, right? Imagine if all AI was open sources, or open sourced, and then a terrorist uses it to learn how to make a nuclear bomb. All right, there's like a, it's just one example. So there needs to be some forms of regulation in place, at least. And I think there needs to be essentially like a segment of our government that's designed specifically, set aside, that governs and regulates AI. And we need to make sure that the AI tools are going to be usable for the general populace. In the same way that we have our utilities, such as water, electricity in some states, sewer, garbage collection. I know in Texas they're not usually public companies, but for example, when I used to live in Washington before I came back down to Texas, you know, water and electric was ran by the county, and the prices were pretty nice. You know, the profit margin from that was taken out. That, you know, a lot of the, I think we were doing like 9 cents a kilowatt there when it was like 13, 14 down here in Texas. The tricky part here is that AI tools are gonna be so powerful that the companies that create these AI tools will have such a strong monopoly over them that we need to be prepared to basically fight that, to fight for our human rights to have access and benefits from these tools and not to have all of the profits being taken away from all these jobs. Because think about our society right now. If a company treats a bunch of workers very poorly, they can unionize, they can go on strike, they can quit their jobs, they can move to another company that treats them better. What happens when it's all done by an AI? We don't have that power anymore over the companies to respond to them. If the only product that's available is created by an AI, then and a human just can't compete because it takes a human 10 hours to do the task that the AI does in a minute, we're almost always gonna be picking the more economical choice. And that's gonna be the tricky part. It's gonna be a two-edged sword. It's gonna benefit humanity, and at the same time, it's gonna take a large part of our autonomy away. So we need to protect against malicious actors. For example, countries like Russia using AI to divide our own country, to create fake images that are controversial images, or And then to spread hatred on places like Reddit, Facebook, YouTube. We need regulation around what AI can create and communicate, for example, like how to create bombs. We need politicians in office that understand the threats and benefits AI can bring, and we need politicians who prioritize the benefits of AI for the general population. We need that badly in government. Right now, we have a whole bunch of politicians who literally just don't understand AI at all. The vast majority of them are over the age of 60, and they're like, what is a smartphone practically at this point? They're like a little bit familiar with smartphones, right? So we've got a long way to go on that front. Abhishek, how much time we got? What's that? How much time? 5-10 minutes? Okay, so I'm gonna show you some examples before we go to coffee break of things AI have made, and some of them are a bit silly, and some are a bit awesome, so let's go ahead and do that next. All right. So that photo right there was that taken by a human or made by an AI? It's made by an AI. Surprise, surprise. But that looks amazingly real. That was a prompt that was like 20-something-year-old man walking down the street or something like that. That's incredible. Okay, so this video was entirely made with AI and a little bit of humor and human interaction. There we go. And it is a Star Wars film if it was made by Wes Anderson. And it's a minute long, so we're just going to take a look at this.
Far, far away, prepare for a reboot like never before. This summer, Wes Anderson brings you a side of the Star Wars universe you've never seen before, the Galactic Menagerie. Join this ragtag crew of unlikely heroes as they navigate the absurdity of the cosmos, challenge the Empire, and redefine what it means to be a rebel.
Our mission is simple. We steal the Emperor's artifact, save the galaxy, and maybe find ourselves along the way.
For this mission, we'll need lightsaber, blaster, thermal detonator, paper airplanes, spare parts, and R2-D2.
With a star-studded ensemble featuring the galaxy's most eccentric cast, the Galactic Menagerie is the most delightfully offbeat Star Wars adventure yet. Starring Timothy Chalamet.
Okay, so I believe that was all that was downloaded before I left the internet. So between coffee break and here, we'll try to get on the internet so we can do some more live interactions. But that was, all those images were created by AI. The motion inside the images were created by AI. The art style was kept consistent by the way they phrased it when interacting with AI. All of that was done with AI with a little bit of human tweaking. This is an ad for a Pizza Hut competitor called Pepperoni Hug Spot, and it was scripted, created with AI, voiced overed, and animated all with AI, and it's pretty hilariously bad, or wonderful, I mean, but it gives you a little bit of hope for humanity for a little while here, that we can still compete against AI for a bit. But here's an example.
Are you ready for best pizza of life? Bring friends down to Pepperoni Hug Spot. Our chefs make pizza with heart and special touch. Cheese, pepperoni, vegetable, and more secret things. Need delivery? Pizzas come fast. Knock, knock, who's there? Pizza magic. Eat Pepperoni Hug Spot pizza. Your tummy say thank you. Your mouth say, mmm. Pepperoni Hug Spot. It's like family, but with more cheese.
So, that gives you a good example of where AI still has some room to grow. Facial animations, little things like, did you notice his pizza box that he was going in the door when he was like doing delivery? It was like all misshapen and like a little bit like not layered correctly and stuff like that. Like that's the kind of thing that AI struggles with. I'm not sure if this loaded all the way. Let's see.
Bye.
So this is a Boston Dynamics, which is going to show you some of the robotic engineering that they've done. So the AI in these robots are designed to teach them how to balance, how to move, learn the movements, learn how to copy human movements. And this is basically the robots having learned a dance from, I believe, analyzing human dance. And this is their interpretation of it.
'Cause I couldn't dance. You didn't even want me around. And now I'm back to let you know I can really shake them down.
Okay, so that gives you a good idea. Those those robots, they're going to be able to learn from human movement just by watching a human do a task, right? They're going to be able to just say, okay, Starbucks barista, make an espresso. Then the robot does it. That's going to be the point we're going to get to, especially when you combine the power of digital image analyzation, so the AIs are going to be able to look at what they're seeing and understand it. Then they're going to integrate that with our language, so what we say. So we're going to be able to give verbal commands, and the AI is actually going to be able to contextually understand it well and then execute these tasks. And that's, like I said, it's going to just wipe out most of the jobs that we have today that are like physical or manual labor oriented, just this one application alone. At least when it becomes economic to do so. Right now, they're very expensive still, but yeah. Okay. So this is Star Wars, if all the characters were buff, called Swole Wars. This was made in Midjourney. That's Luke Skywalker. Oh, we're gonna have to get on the internet to get this one, so maybe it's a good time to transition to our coffee break. Yeah, good time? Okay, Alexis is giving us the thumbs up, so go ahead and go to coffee break. We'll get on the internet and we'll interact with some AIs here and look at some more images. What's that? Yeah. No, let me just get on the internet real quick, and then we can. I just want to make sure that this is ready to go. We're good. But question. Make your comment or whatever. Thank you.
junk man down the street. He's looking for some trash. He ain't got no home. But the shit piles up and stick with broken glass. It's a menagerie he calls his own. I'm walking by his grocery cart thinking about my past. I got some garbage all my own. And I'm looking for Jesus in the old man's face. But now the prophet is long gone. And his head is hanging low. He's got no place to go. And all he can do is eat and sleep and hope tomorrow that he'll know. Somebody done told somebody something wrong. Cause the church bell is fake and plays a tired old song. And the birds and the dogs got it all figured out. They know when to scream and shout. And Fat Lady Hutchinson yells at the kid, get out of my yard and go home. Leave my plum tree alone. The morning has broke like an old window pane. I hear tires rolling down the road. And it's gas and steel that we have to thank to get us to where it is. We don't know. And the doctors fix the sick by cutting out the disease. But they ain't really found no cures. The preacher makes a killing off the congregation who's willing, telling them, hey, heaven is for the poor. And our heads are hanging low. And we got no place go. And all we can do is eat and sleep and hope tomorrow that we'll know. Somebody done told somebody something wrong. Cause the church bell is tired and plays the same old song. And the birds and the dogs got it all figured out. They know when to scream and shout. And Fat Lady Hutchinson yells at the kid, get out of my yard and go home. Leave my plum tree alone. But our heads are hanging low. We got no place to go. All we can do is eat and sleep and hope tomorrow that we'll know, that we'll know.
Took me by my heart that night. Long black hair, short black skirt, with your black bow tie, snow white shade. You took me by
took me by my heart that night. Well, I wish I knew just what I say to make you turn your
head. Mic check. Can I mic check?
Everybody. Always great to have these conversations. I know it's always hard to kind of stop the conversation, so I just want to also use this time to plug the fact that next weekend, since it's 4th of July weekend, we're going to be doing a potluck. So bring a favorite dish, come socialize. That'll be fun. All right, and let's go ahead and welcome Brandon back up here and get started with some Q&A and general ideas.
All right, so let's ask ChatGPT, what is Houston Oasis, humanist organization? Organization in Houston, Texas. Houston Oasis is a secular, inclusive community It was founded in 2012 and aims to provide supportive and engaging community for non-religious individuals and families. Houston Oasis identifies itself as a humanist organization, which means to promote humanist values and ethics based on reason, compassion, and critical thinking. Houston Oasis holds weekly gatherings on Sundays, typically include music, guest speakers, discussions, community announcements, and the organization fosters a sense of belonging, provides opportunities for personal growth, social connection, and community service. That's what the AI spit out with one quick question. So, what questions do you guys have? What should we ask it?
Got a question over here?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Brandon. One of the things that I'm curious about, you mentioned, of course, the utilization of AI in medical applications. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of the data that we have, and we've been amassing huge amounts of data from, you know, the life sciences through social determinants mm-hmm. of health, in EHRs, electronic health records, but they are not structured consistently. And so how good do you think AI is now, and when do you think it will be pretty close to perfect for it to be able to actually take vast amounts of disparate data sets that all kind of are around the same topic and actually come up with something that I would call truly personalized medicine, taking into account your genetics, your social determinants of health, your health history, et cetera, et cetera.
So basically your question is, at what point are the AI doctors going to be better than a real doctor? Is that your question?
Yeah.
You're asking, including all of the human history aspect, your medical records?
See, I actually think that human doctors right now are very much constrained by what they can look at right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm waiting for the time when AI can go way beyond what a human doctor can actually process in terms of data
right.
at this point.
Oh, I'm sure the AIs are already at that point where they can learn your own personal history. It's more just a matter of, has it been put into the AI model and done data mining, deep learning, and machine learning on that data? And if it has, then it can use that data in the prognosis of the, you know, so, yeah. What's that?
Eric.
Watson does that. Watson's been marketing to making medical diagnoses.
Right. Based on personal history, is that right? That's what she's asking.
You can provide it, yeah. I mean, it will take in clinical information and make a diagnosis.
What she's saying is if the system already had it in the system. But
yeah.
At this point, I don't think, because of all the laws around medical information, I don't think that would be possible. So you'd have to consent and provide the
right.
system with that information. So,
but I do have a question too. So for ChatGTP, go ahead and type in what are the social classes that it predicts will result from broad application of AI?
Broad application? So it usually, it does this when you ask the ChatGPT. See this? It says, as an AI language model, I can provide some insights into potential effects of AI. Same thing, there'll be disclaimers if you ask it a medical question or a certain, like, basically what would be like an essay question. It would always be like, this is not, do not use this as an essay and stuff like that. So that's what this is. This is beginning here, is like this disclaimer, and then the actual answer to the question is down here. Technological elite, displaced workers, AI-assisted professionals, gig economy and precarious work, and data capitalists. Those are the five it predicts based on your question. All right, do we have another question for ChatGPT, and then we'll move into some other stuff.
So let's see if I can help your question. So problem statement is something like, your personal health information is kept across multiple systems and insurance companies or whatever, and so doctors have a hard time anticipating problems because they can't see everything that you've done at the emergency room in addition to your primary care provider. Is that kind of where you're going? Right, well, so if the problem is a matter of data, right, so the reason doctors can't predict stuff is because they don't have enough information or they can't process that much information, then if you nationalize personal health information and then feed that to the AI doctor, could the AI doctor be smarter, predictive across both individual people and across like epidemiology generally,
yeah.
like create a 10-step process to nationalize personal health information and then go to the next step of do something with that?
Absolutely, that's possible, and it's more a matter of legal ramifications and who do we trust with all of that data if we were
yep.
to do that.
Okay, so my question is, so one of the things you said is, in effect, you're kind of saying that artificial intelligence might need to be considered common good, right? Like water and electricity and
right,
telephones.
Like a common utility almost.
Well, if that's true, are you also then advocating like nationalization or at least opening the limitation of private industry to artificial intelligence?
I think I'm open to that idea. I think that maybe a better methodology would be to have a higher hiked up tax rate on any company that benefits from AI and then using that fund to basically do, because think about it. If there's only 10 million real human jobs in America, and we have 300 million people in the country, that's 290 million displaced workers. How are they gonna live? What are they gonna do? I think we need to prepare for this potential eventuality. I don't think we're gonna see that probably in our lifetime. Maybe in our lifetime, at the end of my lifetime, maybe. It's hard to say. It's hard to predict how fast AI goes, because it can go really fast when it picks up speed. And then other times it runs into these hitches, you're like, wait, I thought it would go right past that, and then it can't get past this for like forever, it seems like, so.
So, hello? What you're kind of saying is that there's a corporate responsibility for the companies that create AI, not unlike the corporate responsibilities of early industrialization of America, right?
Kind of, but on a much more extreme degree. Because of the, you know, industrialization is only like the empowering of mass production. This is going to be like that times 100, you know, removing of jobs and all of that is going to be, jobs that you never thought could be removed will be eventually replaced. I would really love to show you guys some AI image generation, but if you guys would rather ask questions, we can also do that. So.
Could we get one more question and then play around with AI?
Sure, okay. Yeah.
So my question is involving what information AI has
AI has access to. Like, for example, if you asked it to summarize an academic article, right? That would bypass the paywall for most academic articles out there, would it not?
That just depends on what has been fed into that AI's like deep learning and data mined. Like, if it's data mined all of those articles, then yes. And that's also true for any image generation, and it's a copyright concern for a lot of people, because AIs are learning how to do art from talented artists, and then they're spitting out these like combinations of amazing art that are based on real human creation. But then eventually the AI, it's gonna be also jumbled and mixed together. There's no way to credit back to the original artists. Adobe is trying to address this by only feeding its AI image generation tools copyrighted stuff that they've paid for access to. So, but other image generating AI not doing that as much.
So, what information does ChatGPT have access to?
I know that it was the most recent update was like September 2021. So, if you're trying to access something that's more recent than that, you're going to have to wait for an update going into the data mining. But I'm not sure. I'm not sure all the different resources, but it's a pretty extensive library of resources.
Okay,
so there's a whole lot of things. I did a couple of questions that I wanted to show you. I asked ChatGPT, should I become an atheist? The decision to become an atheist or to adopt any belief system is a personal one that depends on various factors. As an AI language model, I don't have personal beliefs, opinions, but I can provide you some information. Becoming an atheist means rejecting the belief in the existence of God or a higher power. Some people choose atheism because they, and it goes through a whole explanation. What books would you recommend to read about atheism? The God Delusion, God Is Not Great, Breaking the Spell, Letter to Christian Nation. What books would you recommend for me about Christianity? Mere Christianity, The Case for Christ, Cost of Discipleship. Anyway, pretty interesting. There's a lot of different things in here. Let's move on to, I want to
see
show you guys.
See Far, Far Away. Prepare for a reboot.
Hold on. Swole Wars. Should we get into some Swole Wars and then get into some image generation? Okay, so Luke Skywalker, Princess Leia, Han Solo, Chewbacca, C-3PO, R2-D2. I really like his package here. He's got a really defined package. Darth Vader. Stormtrooper. Obi-Wan Kenobi. Jawa. Pretty hilarious. This one is, if Freddie Mercury were to perform at the 2023 San Francisco Pride Parade, as you know, Freddie Mercury is no longer with us. So this is all just imagining him being aged at the same time of putting him in the scenario. And these are all completely AI generated images. This was Flying Spaghetti Monster in Van Gogh style. So, zooming in here. It's quite the work of art. So when you're working with Midjourney, you actually get four images back, and you can choose which one you like the most, and you can adapt it and do more variations of that specific one that you like, or upscale it. This is another piece of work done by Midjourney. A couple more examples. This was the four options it gave me when I asked it what would the ultimate AI look like in the future. This was a grandma with a demon buddy. This is the Heaven Fest. This was as if, I don't know, if Jesus had a music festival and it was like Catholic themed. It's quite generous. And it's amazing to me that these images are all AI generated. uh. So one thing you can kind of tell this is made by an AI, looking at his hand, look at his thumb, it's like broken. Extra finger here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 fingers. There's oftentimes incorrect numbers of fingers on hands in AI images, at least for right now in this phase of AI. And fingers and hands in general kind of look a bit wonky, like really long knuckles there. I don't think it quite happens like this. Or that. As if Jesus was there in the festival. Grandma smoking a doobie. Jesus comes out of the Bible. It's amazing. So this was some of the cat images. That was they wanted a chubby cat hunting with an assault rifle or something like that. Cat cooking. Policeman inspector cat. I like how one of them is a human with a police cat on his shoulder and another one's the cat himself. And then what is this, like a beaver? Like, okay, so I'd really like, if we can, to hop into actual Midjourney and do a couple of image prompts where we can create some images ourselves. What would you guys like to see? As a what? I was using a cross as a claymore. All right, I don't know what this is gonna make, but we'll find out. Oh, it's a banned action, sorry, man. So Midjourney has regulations against certain types of prompts, such as pornographic prompts or some violent prompts, it depends. Can we get another one? Those cat ones were inspiring me, and I wanted to see a corgi. I don't know. Chubby corgi carrying assault rifle. I don't know. Let's see what that looks like. Eric, you got one? What is it? So assault rifle, I think, is a banned term. Physician as a captain of the Flying Dutchman. Like that? Okay, so it's actually going to be able to make that one. So you can follow it in here, and you can also see what everyone else is creating. So these prompts right here, colorful DNA model, and then it made this. So while it's going, so here is physician as a captain of the Flying Dutchman. Maybe it would be better to use the word doctor, or if you're looking for a modern doctor. You can also, if you're looking to do something specific, you can use a reference image of yourself, for example. You can take a photo of yourself and say, use this person in this scenario, and it'll put your face on the person's head or whatever. So, so this is, like, and with Midjourney, you want to be specific, all right? So the more specific you are, there's the terms you use are hyper important. Think about you gotta think about what that term would do if you typed it into Google Images. What would be the top two or three results? Those are the most likely things. So when you type in physician, Flying Dutchman, it's gonna associate captain, you said captain too. So a physician as a captain of the Flying Dutchman, it really latched on, looks like, to the captain with a Flying Dutchman kind of old style boat in the background. But these images were what it just made based on our prompt. So there is a bit of talent involved in manipulating these AIs, but the better you get at it, the more you get from it, the better you get at phrasing it, the more you can get out of it. So this guy says, I need some car tools and some car engine parts tattoo drawing, not too many, white color, white background, simple. And this is what it came out, so a bunch of car parts. And I think he's gonna get like a car tattoo, it sounded like. So he's probably gonna get something like this from that. Probably the closest thing to what he was looking for. I had some prompts written up. My computer crashed actually between the coffee break, so I think I probably lost that, but imagine Houston, Texas with a flying spaghetti monster over downtown. Don't know what that will do, but let's find out. Part of the fun of interacting with these is just throwing stuff in there and then tweaking from there. And you see what comes out, you know? Yeah. What is it? Odd 3-2? How do you spell it? Audrey 2, like that? And then, what is it? With deity faces, like that? Did it make our flying spaghetti monster yet? Oh, here it is. It's still being made. So you can see our speed, we're 78% done. It's currently a flying spaghetti monster. So here's what we made. So if we want to, we can say, which one of these do we like the best? Like this one, you think? The top left one? Okay, so let's do variations on V1. So it's gonna create a new set of four based on that interpretation. And then we'll see what that looks like. All right, and then we've got this other prompt. Audrey 2, did I spell it right? Everything looks good? Well, I didn't put it in yet, but what are you doing to spell this? It's hard to hear you. Right, is that it? Can you read it? I'm not familiar. So Audrey, did I spell that? A-U-D-R-E-Y? Right. Two, with a number two. And then with deity faces? Okay, so that's what I got in there. I'll put that in there. And let's see here. So here's our new variations of Spaghetti Monster over Houston. All right, so this is done. So we got some with three eyes. And then we got some with two eyes. One eye. There you go. So that gives you a good example there. I'd love to do, let's see. Here's our Audrey 2 with deity faces. Is that what you're looking for? No.
We probably need to wrap it up since it's getting...
Wrapping it up? Okay. So, I think that gives you at least a decent idea of what AI is currently capable of, some interesting applications that will be in the near future. It's something to watch for, and it's something to pay attention to in politics and vote for people that are aware of it and that are going to look for the general good of humanity out of it. That's probably the biggest thing we want to be aware of and try to negate, is using AI for corporate greed. That's basically what I would try to have a balance there, at least, you know? I understand that we need money to innovate these products, but at the same time, we don't want them to be a runaway train where we lose our human rights or ability to enjoy life as much. So anyway, that's kind of my talk. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you. Just stand on my tippy toes. All right, thank you so much. Thank you. All right, so before we have one last song from Joseph Rauma, I did want to let everyone know that lunch today is at Spanky's Pizza. You can find it inside your bulletin, the address for that. You can also find, we've got a QR code. If you want to give some feedback for today, let us know how we're doing, what you'd like to see different. We also have the donation link, for QR code for if you would like to donate to Houston Oasis. We also have the black hat in the back, along with other ways to donate. But with that, let's go ahead and have a final song from Joseph Rauma.
Guys, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for having me. you so much.
Thank you so much, and thank you all for being here today. Remember, next week we're doing a potluck. Bring something to share, or bring something for yourself if you don't feel like sharing. That's fine, too. Have a great week. Keep in touch with us on Facebook, Twitter, email, however you do that. Have a great week.